Doctoral Days. Just a few words to say hello and to give you some information, some additional information. As you know, the event is oriented to the doctoral students of our university, but there are some other people from other universities you are very welcome also here, and hope this will be a good time, these 3 days, for having good relations between us and between you and the different speakers that will be here with us today, tomorrow, and in Friday. Speakers are first as Jan van der Borg, later Paolo will act as a chair of this first morning, and we'll present him. And tomorrow is Rafael Boix from the Universitat de València, and in Friday is Irena Ateljevic from the Zagreb University. And we will have also a very interesting keynote speech from John Tribe from the Surrey University. We will work in a very friendly manner, I think, I guess. It's just during the morning and the different speakers will give us a general vision of their research or the things that they are interested in on working this moment. And then during the evening, or in the case of Jan, at the end of this morning, because he has to come back to Leuven, and you will have the opportunity to share with them your approach, your results, your interest regarding your PhD research. For today, I'm give you information about which ones of you will have this kind of close meeting with him. It will be Isabel Peiró, Jordi López, Andreu Pinyol, Montse Bustos, Mireia Guiz, Isabel Paulino. It will be these six people. Narcís Bassols by Skype. It will be the seven people that will have this opportunity to share with him and to get from him comments about your interests. As you know, it's you have to present 10 minutes maximum idea or question or issue from your PhD thesis, and he will give comments that he will consider. Okay, that's all. For those that you are from any other university, in the table that is in the site, there is information about the code and the password for internet connection. So you could use that. And this evening there is a special session about innovative thinking in research and generation of new capabilities from the insight of everyone to get new opportunities of doing PhD research. It's more, I think, spiritual presentation, not focus in contents, but focus in the way on how you can have a good attitude for developing a PhD research. And at the last day, we'll have also another moment, and that is related of life beyond the PhD dissertation. That it's important, I think. And we will have three speakers that will give you short explanations about, one, about opportunities related to grants and postdoctoral hearing and things like that. Another is that will be done by Carlos García Mellado, that is the head of the research office of our university. Then Julie Wilson, that is from our department, that he has been a postdoctoral fellow in many programs and many opportunities, will give us some information, not information, some feelings about her career. and Stella Marina that is here, Stella, that is our last doctor in our program, and now has been hired by the business department at the Lleida University, will give us some things about how she feels his transit between the PhD and to be a professor in the university in a very short time. Okay, that's right. Anything that you need, please ask us. And it's time for the first presentation. Paolo, if you want, you could introduce Jan van der Borg.
Okay, thank you, Salvador. So yes, I'm presenting the first speaker. As you know, our PhD program and in general the organization of the academic activities of these courses in tourism that we have at the Faculty of Tourism and Geography, they basically stand on three academic research focuses. So we have geography, we have economics, and we have business management. Jan, I would say, is a regional economist, so it's in between economics and geography. I have known him since a very long time, and he's been part of my PhD committee. We have always worked together during my time in Venice and in Rotterdam. And Jan is very clearly doing research on the management of destination from a territorial perspective. He's been involved even at the administrative level in creating solutions for the management of tourism flows, everything. We will tell you today how he was dealing with that. And we have done research on the importance of the creative sectors in cities. We have a very strong focus. He's got a very strong focus on cities, historical cities, big cities. It's very much in deep into urban tourism. He's also part and taking, I think, a full responsibility for a research network that is called Euricor, the European Institute for Comparative Urban Research, that is based in Rotterdam and has done a lot. It's embedded in the Erasmus University, but it's an autonomous institution, and it did, and we've done together within Euricor a lot of research on issues of contemporary cities and tourism culture. Mobilities are among these. Jan is not using PowerPoint in his presentations, but we found him a nice blackboard or whiteboard, so he's using that. And we want to make this, of course, very interactive. So now Jan is going to present you his research approach, the topics that are interesting for him. We have following more or less the same script for the three speakers in these days, but really this will gain from your participation. So feel free to interrupt. We have a lot of time. We have time actually until the coffee break at 12:15, but we are going to make some pause during this 2 hours and a half that we have. But the big coffee break is at 12:15, so we have plenty of time. And give the word to him.
Yeah, thank you very much, Paolo, for and of course this university for having me invited to open these doctoral days. As Paolo said between the lines, we have been very much involved in comparative research, and that is learning from different cases, taking into account the various common features, and then see whether we could sort of contribute to theory regarding lots of different aspects of tourism in cities, industrial cities like Rotterdam, heritage cities, small heritage cities like Venice, and so forth. So for me, being here and being able to discuss some of these issues with you is really a very big pleasure. I'm very sorry that I'm, as Paolo said, a bit old school kind of a type. I mean, I really like to get my hands dirty with the chalk on blackboards. This is a compromise. I'm not even sure whether I'm going to use it, but I think some stuff that I'm going to tell you might be worthwhile just to design some graphs and to get some formulas on the blackboard to just to illustrate some of the things we are going to do this morning. Now, what I'm having in mind is exactly what Paolo already sort of very synthetically explained is I'm going to start off with an economist's perspective on tourism development. It's a very theoretical first introduction. And I'm really trying to be a very sort of orthodox kind of economist. What I'm going to show you in the first part is that there is an incredible need, because of the characteristics of the tourism product, to manage tourism, to shift away from improvisation to tourism policies. And I'm going to then, in the second part of my lecture, I'm going to illustrate this idea by using a number of concrete examples and just showing you how this economical theory works out in cities like Venice, Rotterdam, Barcelona, or whatever. And then the last part will be a bit more experimental, a bit less consolidated, and that will be about my sort of my last contributions, let's call it, to theory, to the knowledge of urban tourism development. So this is going to be the morning. First, the theory, economical theory of tourism development, then seeing how tourism management can deal with the intrinsic issues that make tourism development, if left to improvisation, unsustainable, and then some new kind of issues, ICT and other stuff that might be of interest for you as a consequence of this discussion. I'm not going to sit here and just talk and make I'm really inviting you to interrupt me as much as you can, to ask me questions, to criticize some of the ideas, to see whether we can challenge each other, because I think then this seminar will be truly useful, both for myself, because I want to learn from you, as well as from you. I don't know whether there are sort of technical requirements from me being sitting behind a desk with a microphone. Can I just, is that okay for the Skype and...
No, the Skype is going to be later.
Okay, so that's, so I just can just... Okay, so that's, and if I stand there, that's... I think the room is small enough
not to use a microphone. I think so I'm just standing up and starting this speech. Now, as Paolo said, I'm working in actually in three universities today. I'm working at the University of Venice, which is a very nice university. Paolo knows it very well. Some of you might have been there. Venice is a very small city, and it's flooded with tourists. It's a small art city with a lot of, I think, features that render Venice a very interesting laboratory for tourism research with respect to urban tourism. I'm also working in Rotterdam, which is again a city, an industrial city, former industrial city, port city, which is again another interesting laboratory for the study of urban tourism. Leuven, which is the university that I started working in just 2 years ago, is a bit in between. It's a very small city, it's an art city, student city, and it has some features that reflects the Rotterdam kind of cities, and it's still trying to emerge as a tourism destination. But it's also, to a certain extent, similar to Venice, because it's a provincial city, small one, and it has already some hotspots that are overcrowded. But I get back to that. The fact that I work in these places has helped me over the years to to develop what I'm going to tell you now, to develop what we can call sort of a theory of urban tourism development. Now, as I promised you, I will start off with the theoretical part, the economical part, so that you can understand what the main problems are when you start to develop tourism in urban environments. Now, as you may know, it is not easy to define the tourism supply. It is quite difficult to actually sort of identify with precision what parts of a city, what part of a destination are actually sort of used by tourists and are forming the tourism product. Usually, we are operating a very pragmatical, even tautological definition of the tourism supply. We are just presuming, we are just sort of assuming that everything that tourists are using during their stay in a place, whether they're staying for one day or longer, all the stuff they're doing, they're using, is part of the tourism supply. So it's very much determined by the demand side, what we actually sort of understand with the tourism supply. There are some cities, like Amsterdam, where coffee shops are part of the tourism supply, where brothels are part of the tourism supply. And that is because it's a demand-led kind of definition. You understand that? So it's not sort of something you can predefine, you can predetermine just sitting behind a desk. It really very much depends on actually what the people are doing in your city when you want to understand actually what the supply, the tourism product is. Now, notwithstanding, which I think is a good thing, notwithstanding this difficulty of exactly knowing what the boundaries are of the tourism product, I think we can all agree on the fact that the core of the tourism product are the attractions, are the motives for which people are going to come to a place. And these attractions are usually called the primary tourism products, which are in fact the core products for any sort of destination's supply, for the tourism offer. Now primary tourism products can either be natural resources or cultural resources. It can be man-made or sort of created by nature. We can give you some examples of these resources so that I can understand that you know what I'm talking about. Like natural resources could be mountains, beaches, forests, and so forth. Cultural resources, heritage, monuments, squares, museums, and so forth. This is the cultural, the heritage kind of part of the tourism product. Now, from an economist's point of view, these primary tourism products have a lot of characteristics, but the two most interesting characteristics of these primary tourism products are first that these products are for 99% unique and non-reproducible. Can you understand that? Or they are very difficult to reproduce, the 1%. Now, the fact that they are unique is not only because they are unique, because there's nothing else like that, but sometimes there might be things that can be found elsewhere. But because of the fact that the tourism product is a place product, it's uniquely linked to a specific geographical environment, social environment, all of these primary tourism products are unique in a very absolute sense. I mean, you have a lot of churches in Venice, but the church in that neighborhood is unique because it's actually in that neighborhood. It's in that social, cultural, economical context. Yellowstone is a natural park. There are natural parks all over the world, but it is a unique natural park because it's located in that climate, in that environment, and so forth. But this is the first characteristic, which is a very important one from an economic point of view, the fact that they are unique, non-reproducible goods. You cannot remake them. If you lose them, if you destroy them, you lose those natural and cultural resources forever. Now that's a very interesting thing for destinations because it makes people arrive in those places where those resources are not unique. The attractiveness of that place would be less distinct, would be less intense. So that it also has a positive side. But the flip side is that they are sort of also, and that is again something that derives from economic theory, they are what we call scarce. We understand that. We are here faced with a traditional and classical dilemma for the economist that we have to deal with scarcity. And it's not relative scarcity like you can have for sports cars or expensive watches where you cannot, you can reproduce them, but in this case we're really talking about scarcity from an absolute point of view. This is the first characteristic. Remember that. Now the second characteristic of these primary tourism products is the fact that most of them are public goods. You know what public goods are? Public goods. Sorry? Yeah, squares, they belonging to nobody and to everybody. There's no possibility, in fact, to exclude, for example. There's non-excludability. But from an economist's point of view, what is even more important is that it's very difficult to just leave these goods to the market. Because there's no market for a square, for a mountain, for a beach. No direct possibility to exchange these goods on a market square. Okay. Now, if there's no market, can you understand that? If there's no market for these goods, what will their price be? Their price or shadow price?
It's a question.
That's a question. If I start with what, then I intend to ask you something. I think this is a really fundamental part of, I think, the construction of a theory of the management of tourism resources and of the development of tourism in any sort of kind of destination. If you cannot sort of sell a beach or a church or a square, as you were suggesting, or on the market, just put it on eBay. No, it's not possible with this kind of primary tourism products. What does that mean for the price of these goods?
I think that there are some trends into the privatization of the public space that suggest that actually some public goods could be sold. There are they're changing flows, the public demand is putting on the market.
Yeah, that is a policy reaction. That is a policy reaction to the paradox that I'm trying to explain. We were just discussing in the car the closure of Park Güell, for example, where the public space, you just close it and you ask a price for it. But notwithstanding, there is something that bothers me with that price. Even if you're closing it and you're asking people to pay a ticket, if you're not truly able to use the market, what can you tell me about the price? Sorry?
It doesn't have a value. You can't put a value for public goods. Sometimes it's...
Yeah, it has a value, but the price people are paying for that is either zero, if it's still a public good in the strict sense. So if you come to Venice, you just walk around in Venice. What is the price you're paying?
For walking.
It's nothing. The price is not. If you just walk around in Barcelona, what's the price you're paying? Nothing. If you're not going to these privatized public parts of the system. Or the price is a political price. And still that price is in no ways related to the intrinsic value that these resources have. I mean, a church in Venice where you have two paintings of Tintoretto. You go there, you go in, and you're not paying anything. But what is the intrinsic value? Because what you were saying you're mixing price with value. The value of these products, of these sort of primary tourism products, is immense. It's incredible. Yeah, there's no relationship between the price that actually people are paying and their willingness to pay / the use value of these resources. This use value is incredible. It's really incredible. And what is the user value for a person that visits the Sagrada Familia? What is that? How much is that? Is that corresponding to the ticket or not?
It depends
on the type of visitors, but we get back to that.
But you're not owning later part of the Sagrada Familia, you're not buying. You're paying for
the experience.
For the experience.
Yes.
And this is also market valuable. I mean, there are so many pieces related with Gaudi heritage. You talk about Sagrada Familia. The logic of the political price, I don't know.
Yeah, political pride, whatever.
It's far from being actually applied. So I think there are, now I don't know in detail the price, how they define the price for the entrance in Sagrada Familia, but probably they also see around what's happening. I mean, they look at the market as well for defining that price.
Yeah, well, in some cases there is this tentative to establish that something, for example, but we get back to these practical things later. The example of cities like Venice that want to implement a ticket, for example, to getting into Venice, so they try to take away some of what we call the consumer surplus from the people that visit Venice. Because obviously, from a consumer's point of view, if your user value is very high, and I'm really talking about economics now, let's design. Who knows what consumer surplus is? That's why I wrote this report. If this is a market price and quantity, this is a simple market, and this is the equilibrium price, then everything that the consumer is paying, which is below their willingness to pay, which is measured on the demand, this is the supply curve, this is the demand curve, this part is the consumer surplus. So anytime you are willing to buy a pair of shoes for 100 euros and you're paying 50 euros, you experience a consumer surplus of 50, which is very nice. So just imagine if something doesn't cost you anything, walking in Venice, just walking around in the, on the Ramblas or something like that, but it gives you use of though you this consumer surplus is used. So when you start to price according to this willingness to pay, to the user value, you actually sort of take away some consumer surplus of your visitors. But we get back to that, because that is something that you have to use, of course, instruments, theories, theoretical things that you have to use when you start to manage them. Paolo.
Maybe you are getting to that, but I would say that there are many public goods in tourist destinations that don't have a price, but the price is sort of internalized in the price of the services of the city. So you pay a lot more for a hotel that is in.
Yeah, which is a different issue related to that. Of course, the tourism industry very often is free riding. It's free riding on the user values that the primary tourism products are actually sort of creating. If you look at the hotels in Venice, they are 50% more expensive than in Mestre. And the only difference, the price difference, lies in the fact that the hotels in Venice give a direct access to the primary tourism products, not because they're more luxurious or better or whatever. Same quality or even a less quality, double the price, but that's indeed because they're free riding on the access they are giving to the primary tourism product, which is located exclusively in the historical center. I think the same is true for Barcelona. There's some parts of Barcelona where hotels are more expensive because they give access and they're free riding on this user value. But we get back to this when we talk about management. But just understand for the time being that the combination of uniqueness, of absolute scarcity of primary tourism products, and the fact that there is no market price that reflects the intrinsic value of these resources, is causing us a lot of problems. This combination of scarcity, of non-reproducibility, and the absence of a true market price that reflects the user value is the source of all the problems that I'm observing in destinations. And I get back to the personal questions, yes.
I'd like to say that maybe a problem that is finding public goods is that most of them are impossible to relate the access or not. Because it's impossible to close the area and say, here you have to pay a ticket.
Yeah. So sometimes it's impossible, sometimes it's possible, but yet the price is still, for me, symbolic or political.
Then, in this kind of products, some of them are immaterial products, or maybe also there are some ecological products. I think the price can be put in the experience, giving an extra value for the tourist and giving to the person experience. The access is free, but putting a price.
You organize something within that, and that can be priced, and that can be sort of used to as a vehicle
As it's impossible to regulate the access, this can be a solution.
Yeah. You're already sort of thinking in terms of solutions, of management, of policies. Let's see later in this lecture what kind of policies we have to try to see whether we can get these two things matching again. But let us for the time being saying this: public goods, the core of this, of the core of the tourism offer, are public goods, primary tourism products. They're not only public goods, but they're also non-reproducible, therefore scarce from an absolute point of view. Now, what is the, because our mission is a, as a tourist economist, our mission is very clear. What is our mission, according to you? What is my mission? If a destination calls me to give them advice, what is my mission as a tourism economist? Which is actually what Paolo was really trying to tell you when he said that I'm a regional economist. What is my mission?
To regulate.
No, not necessarily. That's the consequence. Exactly. This is my mission as an economist. Not only maximizing the benefits, but let us say that my mission is to see how the resources, the tourism resources that those places are possessing, are used in an optimal way, which is, of course, maximizing the benefits and minimizing the cost in the long term. We get back to this long term thing, because I think that is a fundamental issue. It's very easy to maximize in the short term and lose, of course, these benefits in the longer. Short term is easy. Now, what is the traditional answer of an economist to the optimal allocation problem? Yeah, that is indeed just leave everything to improvisation, to the market. Sorry? Yeah, the neo-capitalist, the neoliberal kind of economy. Now I can. I'm an economist, so I am. We always have difficulties in communicating. He's a not really a traditional economist, even if Marx has abandoned his jacket. Oh, Lenin. No, still on the jacket. I'm too much economist to believe that there are no markets that can be left to improvisation. I think there are some markets or some goods that can be left to, that are sort of more or less ruled by perfect competition. Maybe sugar or salt or, I don't know, Coca-Cola. There might be some products that can be left to improvisation, to the market, to market forces, to the invisible hand of Adam Smith or whatever. Although I'm also a critical economist, I don't believe that the market is the solution. It's not a solution for most of the societal problems. I'm critical as well. But I can even understand that some markets, some goods might be sort of ruled by this invisible hand. But in this situation, this traditional answer of my colleague, the economist, so just leave it with the market, is not working. Because if you have this sort of this, I think it's an explosive mix of characteristics, public goods and unique goods, non-reproducible. This combination is an alarm bell that tells us economists with a mission to maximize the benefits and minimize the costs in the long term. It tells us that we cannot leave this stuff to the market. We should be embracing an alternative paradigm. In fact, if we just look around, if we just, because this is theory, now let's look at practice, let's look at the empirical kind of stuff. If we just look around, we immediately observe that in most destinations, especially in the long term, improvisation leads to non-optimal allocations, leads to a non-optimal use of tourism resources. I think 99% of destinations that are left to improvisation, sooner or later, get into some kind of non-optimality with respect to the use of their resources. Now there are two big families of non-optimal use of the resources. who can illustrate with those two families? And then we have some Spanish examples or Italian examples or Belgian examples of non-optimal use. What are those two big families? Of non-optimal use of tourism resources, which are almost inevitable if you just leave stuff to the market, to improvisation, to some tourism entrepreneurs or people from Macau to redevelop areas close to.
For instance, Benidorm.
Yeah, so there's two families. One family might be the Benidorm family. What are the characteristics of this Benidorm, Venice, Bruges family of destinations?
Mass tourism.
An excessive use of the tourism resources. Why is that not optimal? You're getting over the capacity of the destination. And what does that mean for the tourism resources?
The use is much bigger,
so they're consuming the essence of the destination. And since the resources they're consuming are non-reproducible, also the long-term perspective for tourism itself is jeopardized, is compromised. Can you understand that? I spoke with the mayor of Benidorm 3 years ago, and he said, my city is so ugly that I think we might be a good candidate for the UNESCO heritage site. So it's so typically sort of mass touristically developed with all these hotels which they make a lot of efforts to have the rooms with the view on the, I don't know how they build them, those hotels, but they all have a view on the sea. It's really incredible. He said, well, we are so ugly and so unsustainable that we applied for the UNESCO candidature. I don't know whether he did that or not. I think the Benidorm model is one family of non-optimal use. It's an excessive use of the resources. It's a violation of the carrying capacity. We get back to the carrying capacity issue later when we're talking about responses to this, and it's a situation in which, in the end, the local society, the local economy, and also tourism itself tend to get eroded. So that is not optimal at all. But there's a second family. Underdeveloped? Yeah, underused tourism resources, which is the second family of non-optimal use. Give me some examples.
Naples.
First, see Naples, then die. It's really one of the most beautiful cities in the world, Naples. It's far more beautiful than Barcelona. I think it has more intrinsic resources. Why is that non-optimal?
And, but it's generally accepted that the use of this cultural heritage or aesthetic heritage could be valorized for driven tourist development. Actually, it's not very well, it's underused. Potentially, an optimal.
But why is that a scandal? Why is that something that hurts an economist, a regional economist?
Create more business.
Yeah, you could create social and economic development, jobs, and so forth by using the resources you have much better. Simple. So Naples, indeed, the tourism policy in a place like Naples is quite very different from the tourism policy in a place like Benidorm. Should be trying to valorize, to stimulate, to incentivize the use of these resources to make people in the place better off. Because in the end, it's, for me, tourism development is always about the people that possess the resources, which are the local host community. So this is the evidence. The evidence that we have is that if you leave tourism indeed to improvisation, to the market, to the invisible hand, you end up in having southern Italian beach resorts with no clients, art cities like Naples with not enough tourism demand, or the Barcelonas with too much people walking around, people getting sick and tired of having tourists around all the time, or the Venice or Benidorm kind of things.
Yeah, I just want to get into what you were saying before. I will say that Benidorm is a case of that.
Oh, she said that.
Yeah, she said that. Benidorm has a logic of massification that has nothing to do with our overexploitation of the public good. I would say Benidorm is built as something that is structurally working with the person and doesn't face probably the only limit that it has is the use of the beach. But that is not a problem in Benidorm. I would focus mostly on urban spaces of the traditional type, because that is where clearly the spaces have not been designed for tourism users, and where it's easier in a way to overuse the public good.
Don't you think there's also natural destinations which might face the problem of an excessive use?
But so in that case, you would be suggesting that Benidorm is going to be depleted in terms of attractiveness or competitiveness of the product because there is an overexploitation of it, and I don't think so. Benidorm is just being reproduced as a...
I don't know. I've been to Benidorm just once. For me, it was a place to avoid when I was a small kid. Some places you better not go. You were going to Benidorm, you were classified as a Dutchman belonging to a specific kind of like a social economic taboo. But it might be a place which is actually well managed. But I still think that in terms of the quality of tourism, in terms that they might be getting the same numbers as they did, but I still think there is, because that's what the mayor was talking to me, and that's why he wanted to get this UNESCO sign on the things of the city, on the outskirts. He said we are not even in quantitative terms, but economically and socially speaking, in qualitative terms, we are sliding down.
Yeah, well,
we see that the margins of our firms are being reduced. With lower margins, they are not able to invest in quality, and that starts to become a problem. I don't know. I don't know Benidorm that much to call with.
But then the problem is not the exploitation of the public good. The problem is slightly.
It's the non-optimal. It's the non-optimal use of the term.
Yeah. But if you are talking about maximizing this economic return, maybe we can also think that a development of quality tourist supply doesn't help some place to reach this maximization.
Yeah, but I'm not talking, because I think we have to be very careful. I'm not talking about the maximization of benefits as such. I'm talking about the optimization, which is both measured on the benefit side and also on the cost side. Okay? So what I'm doing is to maximize the difference between all kinds of benefits and all kinds of costs. Not not necessarily just maximize the benefits of us. We understand that. It's not a maximization of the benefits as such. It's a long-term maximization of the difference between costs and benefits. And we get back to that, but what I'm seeing in the places that are not optimally used, the benefits are usually much lower than they could have been, and the costs are much higher than they could have been. We get back to that. And then you may tell me whether Benidorm fits that picture or not. I don't know that much about Benidorm, and more than I saw and that I spoke with the mayor. We get back to that. But this for me is a fundamental point that you should be trying to keep in mind in the rest of the discussion that we are having. Leaving the stuff to the market, to improvisation, the absence of tourism policies or tourism strategy is very often leading either to the underdevelopment of places, and I think also in Spain, in Spain, there's so many, I think, art cities which have not been touched by tourism development, in which people are actually losing social and economic development potentials. But on the other hand, we have also places which are excessively developed. Might be parts of Barcelona, might be Costa Brava or whatever. That is the idea. Now it's very funny because they are really, and our city is a very good example of that. And maybe even Barcelona, there are also places in which you can find situations of overexploitation and underexploitation in just sort of 10 kilometers of distance. I think that's also the case of some parts of Barcelona where more could have been done with the resources and also to help the social and economic development of that neighborhood. And nothing is happening there. Well, just 10 kilometers from that place, you have too many people walking around. In Venice, it's a bit the same, man. Castello, San Pietro di Castello, the outskirts of the historical center, just 2 or 3 kilometers from the same San Marco Square. They're almost empty. It might be better like that, I don't know, but that's something that we can discuss later. But there are situations of under and over exploitation in just really small geographical spaces. Now, just to get back to this pricing mechanism and the use value, in the cases of an excessive use of tourism resources, it's obvious that the consumer, since there is no sort of true price for the resources, it's obvious that the consumer does not perceive any kind of scarcity with respect to the tourism resources. Can you understand that? There's no person that comes to Venice as an excursionist, as a visitor just for the day, and that walks around in Venice with his kids or whatever, that perceives, because there's no price that tells you that perceives Venice as a scarce good. They don't perceive that. People going to the beach with their cars just for the day, and they're not perceiving any scarcity because our mindset is made to perceive scarcity of goods most commonly and effectively through the price. We are all used to that, or not. I mean, we are now living in this economy of the limited edition. Can you tell me something about that? Are you victims of the limited editions or not? I am. Now there's Chupa Chupa limited editions. They cost a bit more. There's sneakers, sports shoes with limited edition kind of thing. And every time that the industry is proposing is a limited edition, and we are willing to pay a premium price. So the pricing is telling us exactly how we should be behaving with respect to that limited availability good. So if there's no price, in fact, we are not, as a consumer, not really truly understanding the situations of absolute scarcity. And on the other hand, if there's no market price, in the case of an underutilization of tourism resources, the tourism industry doesn't understand what treasure they have in their hands, actually. It's very much the case of these underdeveloped places, the tourism industry, since there is no one paying a price for something, they don't even understand how valuable, potentially valuable, these resources might be for tourism development and hence for social and economic development of the region. Can you understand that? So the lack of a price for me is really, and the lack of the market is really something that we should be focusing our attention on. Because that is actually for me the source of all these situations in which destinations are not using their resources optimally, and that is exactly the mission of the tourism economy, to guarantee this optimal utilization, which is different from the maximization of the benefits. It's slightly different. Question?
There's another element which is also important, which is you can have a very scarce unique resource, but if nobody knows it or knows the potential or the importance of it, then the price doesn't matter because you don't get the idea of what the price is.
But
the notoriety, the notoriety of the resource, it's also important.
Yes.
You can have something very, very unique, but everybody knows some companies, maybe nobody knows, the Bay of Azov tax in the Belt of the Lever, which is something very unique, but nobody knows about that.
Yeah, but here you have a very, I think you're perfectly right, here you have a very sort of important example of some kind of prisoner dilemma. Who is, if there's no price, if nobody perceives the value, neither the demand side nor the big actors, at the supply side of the place. Who starts to set this process in motion? And who should be breaking this prisoner dilemma? Of course, it's the public, the public sector. And that is exactly my claim, that it should be always not improvisation, not the main sort of way of dealing with tourism development issues, but it should be a tourism policy. There should be somebody in the public sector that says, well, I think that the resources we're possessing are much more valuable than the market thinks they are. And that is because they are not well informed. So the information thing is a very big issue, I think, in tourism policy. But that's already, what you are suggesting is already, I think, confirming the idea of intrinsically improvisation leads to non-optimal use. The only thing you can put against that is an adequate, innovative tourism policy, a planner who actually sort of has an idea, a vision, a long-term vision on what should be done with these resources. Now, back to this problem, because I said, well, this paradigm, this traditional paradigm of our colleagues, of our economists, colleagues, of just leaving stuff to the invisible hand is not working. Just look around and you see so many examples of non-optimal use of resources that you actually sort of have to conclude that there is a need for an alternative paradigm. We've been doing research in finding this alternative paradigm. And for me, the alternative paradigm, even if it's a bit an overused kind of thing, is the paradigm of sustainable development. Sustainable tourism. Because the idea, who knows what the idea is, the basic ideas of sustainable tourism development, which in fact are compatible with the stuff that we said before. We began talking about theory. Sustainable development, well, there's this classical definition from the Munich Genera 1992 kind of conference, the Brundtland Report, so it's already quite an old-fashioned kind of thing. And most sustainability issues have already been incorporated implicitly in many kinds of policies. But the idea of sustainable development was to use the stuff that you have, but up to a certain point in which you still guarantee the possibility of future generations to use the same stuff in the same way. So again, I get back to what you were saying. It is the sustainable development paradigm is indeed something that deals with the long-term kind of issues. Because it's about future generations. And if you're telling people to use stuff, to use resources, to use then you are already sort of in a, as my mindset is working, you're already working as an economist in terms of the optimal allocation. Because you can use the stuff. What you should be finding is an optimal allocation according to this sustainability kind of paradigm. There's an optimal allocation of the resources in a long-term perspective. So I think the sustainability paradigm and sustainable tourism development is perfectly sort of compatible with the idea that we were discussing before. You should be trying to optimize these resources in a long-term perspective. Now what I want to do next, and now we have understood the basics, the elements, the key issues with respect to tourism development, and why there's a need for adequate tourism policies. But what I want to do next is to make this idea of sustainable tourism development, and I'm going to do it especially for urban settlements, for urban kind of situations, to make this idea of sustainable tourism development a bit more concrete, a bit more so easy to touch, easy to understand. And I don't need again this whiteboard, because what I've been doing, sometimes also with Paolo, is to see whether we can find some sort of traditional tools in tourism theory that might help us to understand this idea of sustainability a bit better. And the two classical tools that I'm using are cost-benefit analysis on the one hand, and the life cycle theory of tourism development on the other. You know these, so it's cost-benefit analysis, again emphasizing the fact that we're not only interested in benefits in income, in money, in dollars, in euros, but we're also very much concerned about the costs with respect to tourism. And on the other hand, the second tool, which is a tool that is commonly used in tourism analysis, is this idea of the tourism life cycle. Because I think this tourism life cycle actually gives us an idea about this long-term perspective. What happens with destinations if you're not intervening drastically in tourism development from a planner's point of view, or if there's no disaster which is sort of changing your life cycle. You've ever seen this tourism life cycle? It was designed, invented by Richard Butler. I think he's now in Bournemouth or Surrey?
He's retired.
He was in Bournemouth in Surrey, I don't know what first and what last. He's a very nice English geographer. He wrote this article in 1980 on how destinations were developing over time. I think still his life cycle theory has a lot of merit. We'll get to the back of that. This other thing, this cost-benefit analysis, is even a more simpler tool. It's just an inventory of the positive and the negative aspects that are related to tourism development. So you can choose what you want to hear first. It's in the combination that we're going to talk about sustainable development. You want first, because benefit analysis, or first the life cycle theory of Butler. I met Butler in 1999. Paolo was talking about how long we are knowing each other. When we started working in 1995 on the telecom project, and I knew him before, because I'm not going to tell you this. Because he came to Rotterdam as an Erasmus student. I think he just stayed for how many days?
Oh, 24 hours.
24 hours. He came to Rotterdam and went back. And this is a place where I can stay. A lot of also other things. Then he came back to Rotterdam to do his PhD. His memory and PhD, so things change in life. It's exactly this life science. 1994 or something? Three? Anyway, Butler has a very nice wife. She drinks very much Madeira, and then she starts to
offend her husband. That's what I think about when I see Butler's life cycle. I think about his wife who were in Madeira, and she drank too much.
So what do we do first, Butler or the cost-benefit analysis thing?
Butler,
life cycle. Has anybody heard of this life cycle theory apart of some of the... Yes or no? Yes, it's a very simple thing. Let's do it very quickly. Now, Butler says, very simply, Butler says in 1980 something that not many scientists understood at that moment in time. Butler said that tourism development path of any destination is not something continuous. You cannot grow as a tourism destination infinitely, but there are sort of periods, stages of growth, stagnation and decline. Now what Butler actually did was very simply translate the product life cycle that was used by our colleagues in business economics already for a decade or so. He just used and transformed the product life cycle into the life cycle of the destination. I think the genial part of his transformation was not that he applied the life cycle, but was his assumption that the destination as such was a holistic product. It's one thing. Because before Butler, all our colleagues, mostly geographers and social scientists, were looking at the destination from different kind of perspectives. They didn't have this holistic view of the destination. I think Butler, by considering the destination as one product, so not hotels, and restaurants, and attractions, and nature. But the fact that he assumed that all these things were working together in the destinations, which was of course the precondition for applying the product life cycle to the destination, was the genial part of his theory. Now the life cycle simply saying this, I'm going to put visitors here, and I'm going to put time. He says that any destination, in the absence of drastic or political interventions and of disasters, will follow more or less this cyclical kind of path. What are the stages in the cycle for those who know the theory? Very quickly.
If I remember correctly, in development?
Yes, the first stage. Development or birth or whatever, many names.
Exploration,
development, birth, discovery. There's so many sort of labels for the same stage. But what is true that in the first stage, the number of visitors is just rising very slowly. And that's really when the place starts to get known among tourists. Probably well designed. The second stage,
second stage, stage of growth or development, or again, a number of labels. But in that stage, what we see is that the rate of growth of the number of visitors is increasing. So you get the first year 1,000 extra visitors, the second year 2,000 extra visitors, the third year. So it's an explosive kind of growth process. Explosive, incredible. Then we have this third stage, which is the stage of
consolidation,
maturity. Sorry?
More competence.
Yeah, more competition, or you're fighting with other destinations to get people to your place. But it's a station where the number of visitors starts to stop increasing. So it's 1,900, 800. And you see that the number of visitors is going towards this sort of maximum kind of demand. And then you have the fourth stage of decline. Decline or crisis or whatever you want to call it. And fortunately, a potential fifth stage of rejuvenation or rebirth, which is nothing more than a new cycle after your first one. It has the same characteristics in terms of numbers. Now, Paul already knows this because this is an issue that we've been studying very intensively in Venice and in many of our researches. I have put this visitor thing on the y-axis for a very particular purpose. Because the fact that I use the label visitors is not something that I do by mistake, but it's something that illustrates the fact that not only the number of people that visit a place is changing in time, but then there's another thing that changes very much, which is a very crucial thing. That's why I take this label of visitors rather than tourists. Because within the label of visitors, I have a lot of different sections that I can include, but there is a distinction that I'm very much interested in, which is the distinction between tourists and excursionists. So I use the label visitors to allow myself to diversify between tourists and excursionists. Now, this thing that I'm going to tell you is something that I did in my dissertation. Is what I introduced in the theory of Butler was the possibility not only to look at the number of visitors that gets into a place, but also to the mixture of the visitors over the cycle. That's why the wife of Butler was so angry with me and with her husband. She said, well, look at those young people, they come to conferences, they use your theory. Couldn't you do more, get more money, more advice work? Look at this. 99 is how many years ago? So what I said was this in my dissertation, and I think this is a very useful thing that we should be remembering, because it has huge impacts on the cost-benefit part of my story of sustainability, is that in the first stage, the majority of visitors will be excursionists. And why is that?
There's no accommodation.
Yeah, there's no secondary tourism product in place yet. There are no hotels. There might be some families that start to host people to get into the place. I remember the Greek islands when they started to develop themselves. Pensions, but not even official tourism accommodations. Families hosting. This is the first stage. Paulo is a much more experienced traveler than I am, and he goes to places where really sort of there are only
huts
and
caves
and whatever. I'm a bit I need my sort of comfort. If I'm getting too old for huts and caves, far away from. But the first stage is very much an excursionist kind of thing. In the second stage, let's do it in red. The red is the tourist kind of tour. In the second stage, that's why I don't have the PowerPoint presentation here correct. In the first stage, no tourists and always excursionists. In the second stage, we have a few excursionists. They are being sort of transformed into residential groups. First they stay there as an excursionist, then they see there's some hotels and they get back to the place and spend the nights there. Or people who started to get information about, oh, this is a nice place to go in the second stage. These places have very nice and interesting primary tourism products. Let's go there. And then you see residential tourism rising. What we have measured in a number of destinations is that the crisis in the residential tourism market is appearing much sooner than the crisis in the total number of visitors. In other words, what we are seeing is that this gap between the total number of visitors and residential tourists, which is the number of excursionists, is getting bigger and bigger while the destination is getting into the peak. Can you understand that? Why is that? Just try to see to understand that. Why should residential tourists abandon the destination before excursionists?
Probably too expensive to sleep there?
It's not only too expensive, but maybe also the visitor experience for excursionists is more satisfactory because they're paying less to have that experience. While residential tourists that are supposed to pay a lot for that same experience, saying, well, now, and we see that happening in Venice, actually. There are many people that have abandoned Venice as a destination. They are now going to Istanbul, or I don't know where exactly. Venice became so crowded, so expensive for the quality that the restaurants and hotels are delivering, that they say, well, we're going to leave Venice to the excursionists. But that's in the consumption theories you can find an explanation for the fact that the peak in residential tourism, this is residential tourism, or tourism, let's call it tourism, and this difference is excursionism. This peak is happening much before there's a peak in the total number. This was my small contribution to the theory of the life cycle, this fact that not only the number of visitors changes over time, over the cycle, but also the composition of the visitor flow tends to change very much over time. Now it's obvious that the change of the composition in the flow of visitors has a huge impact on the cost of the benefits. Can you understand that? And that's why I think we ought to be linking this CBA, the CBA tool, with this life cycle theory tool. So let us look at the costs and the benefits.
what are the main benefits of tourism development? Simple, it's really simple, straightforward. Jobs, very important benefit, very important, especially in countries like Italy and Spain. How much in Italy, 40% of the people that leaves university is unemployed. Young people, incredible, unsustainable. If I were young and unemployed, I would start doing the medical thing. Against the people who administer the country. Spain?
Worse.
Is it worse, or is it like worse in Spain than in Italy, or?
Young unemployment is about 50%, like from 16 to 25 year olds.
Yeah, that's is that unsustainable or not?
Okay.
Is that something that cries for drastic and dramatical action, or? How can a country permit itself to leave the best part of the labor market, the most innovative, the most dynamic, not excluding ourselves from the interesting part of it? But I think that is the most, that's the tourism industry should be delivering those jobs. So jobs are an important positive effect, are a benefit.
Risky argument. I mean, Spain has 12% about of GDP related to tourism, and maybe it will be worse, but maybe the tourism is not the solution. So
yeah, it's a risky argument. You can say, well, the people that are employed in the tourism industry are there, the seasonal employment, seasonal jobs, low quality, but sometimes there is no alternative. So I think it is obvious that you need to take this a bit with gloves. But normally speaking, the tourism industry is a job engine. It's creating jobs. That's why so many developing countries, China, India, Vietnam, are developing, or already developed countries, are really pushing tourism development so hard. Because it's a Africa, it's a source. We've been doing research in Leuven to have a look at the tourism development opportunities and economic and social development opportunities in Zaire, and they are huge. So it's a risky thing, and you have to look at the quality of the jobs to see whether indeed it is this. It offers the perspectives to the people that are employed.
Cost opportunity.
Yeah.
You strongly focus on tourism development policies. Maybe you are avoiding the best or focusing
on
another sector.
Yeah.
We are talking about that, for example, in Barcelona, 60% estimated of tourism related GDP and a very high rate of unemployment and very bad quality of employment.
There's land use issues, there's what we talk about, this idea of the crowding out of other economic sectors because of tourism, because tourism is taking away spaces, or it's taking away the best part of the local labor market. So indeed it is a thing that you have to get into.
That's only public investment. Or the optimization of the
not always, but sometimes it needs them. So there's resources diverted to the tourism development process rather than to other types of tourism. So I think you're right when you say you have to take this with the. But I think it's the certainty that tourism development means more jobs, whether it's the jobs you want or whether indeed there could have been other types of development that generate more jobs is something that you need to study very carefully. What else?
Okay, excluding the massive tourism, we can come to revalue of the resources also for the locals.
Yeah, so it's about income. You mean income, money?
I mean
or something more.
The resources, cultural resources or other kind, most in urban tourism, I think the local can take benefits of.
Yeah. So since, and this is a very good point, so we have jobs, we have income, but we also have this effect that since the tourism product, the core of the tourism product, is not an exclusive or an excludable product, and this idea works in two directions. It means that all the resources that are being developed or valorized, or also infrastructure that is being developed for tourism, might also be used for the locals. So their quality of life sometimes gets better because of that very specific point. Give you a concrete example, not linked to the primary tourism product. I live in Venice. I have 4 flights per day to Amsterdam, 4 flights per day to Brussels, I think 2 or 3 flights per day to Barcelona. My city possesses the 3rd airport of Italy after Malpensa and Rome. Sometimes Naples beats us, and then sometimes Naples doesn't. So we are the 3rd airport in Italy. Now, why are we the 3rd airport? Not because of the 100 or 200,000 inhabitants that Venice has and they travel so much, but it's because Venice is a tourism city. We have a film festival, we have a biennale, we have a lot of also cultural facilities that are there because tourists are sustaining their viability. You understand that. And without tourism, a lot of these kind of facilities that are also used by residents, which is exactly the point you are making, wouldn't be in Venice, or wouldn't be in Venice anymore. So in fact, first, jobs, second, income, third, quality of life, or facilities, or social, cultural, and all kind of infrastructure, which is partly sustained by tourism demand. Fourth benefit is a immaterial benefit that has to do with the image of the place. Tourism cities have a very strong, usually stronger brand than non-tourism. Now, the brand is increasingly becoming also an economic development factor, because the brand attracts not only sort of tourists, but strong brand, but also firms, multinationals, the creative class, and so forth. So these are the benefits. So if we're doing a cost benefit analysis, we have to take into account that these are the benefits that we should be working with in optimizing the allocation of our primary tourism product. What are the costs linked and related to tourism development? So many of them.
Negative externalities.
So we have devices. Externalities and non-externalities. Just give me most of these costs.
Well, the fact that you have to pay for services that are delivered to a large mass of people, which becomes translated in higher costs.
Yeah, first, tourism tends to fuel an inflation process, tends to sort of make the costs of living in a popular destination much superior to the cost of living in a similar place with a similar amenities. I don't know. Well, Barcelona is a very good example.
For instance, in the last years, there has been a very sharp increase in the price of public transport.
Yeah, public transport.
As attributable to the fact that there is a very important use of public transport by tourists, but
right,
not taxpayers. So
housing. We had a sandwich, I think, 4 years ago, just close to the market, to this tourist market, close to the Ramblas.
It's not a tourist market, it's a market which is visited by a lot of tourists.
Yeah, well, it's again something that you cannot exclude. Is that, and I think we had a sandwich and a bubble wine, and I mean, we paid about 40 euros, something like that. I mean, this is actually happening in Venice, in Barcelona, in those kind of sort of hotspots for urban tourism. Other costs,
quality of life.
And this, we said that tourism is helping the quality of life, but it's also on the other end, because most of these effects have two sides, two flip sides, costs and benefits. But we get back to that when we're talking about the caring effects. Because the quality of life, ingestion,
natural resources.
Sorry?
Natural resources.
Yeah, wear and tear. You mean?
I mean, for example, the exploitation of, for example, water.
So what are the costs? Pollution. Or indeed, degradation of cultural and natural resources, tear and wear. You can see that in Venice, you can see that in the natural park, it's evident.
Loss of identity.
The loss of identity, the banalization, Paolo calls it the McDonaldization.
Not me.
No, I saw it in one of your papers. But that's
public sources, the overuse of public sources.
Yeah, the overuse of public facilities. Mm. Paolo said it about the transportation. There are so many of these examples. Museums you cannot get into as a local, because there's always queues and queues of visitors. So on the other hand, tourism brings facilities and brings opportunities, but on the other hand, if you get over a certain threshold, which is the carrying capacity and about which we're going to talk later, then the opportunities that residents have to participate in public life are diminished. We talked about the crowding out, the costs of crowding out. Can you understand what that is? And it's linked with the loss, the lack and the loss of identity. And the fact that the tourism industry is so powerful in these kind of hotspots that it tends to push normal urban functions, residential and economic functions, to the outskirts. So it fuels the process of sub or desurbanization, leaving central cities. Venice is a good example. If you go to Venice and you're not over 70 years old, you will see that after 6 o'clock there's nobody actually using the place. There's just a few Santo Stefano, just a few squares, two places close to Rialto and Santo Stefano, which are being used also after 6. But it's quite an empty, it's a ghost town. It's really like a theme park that closes at 6 and everybody goes away. All the regular residential and economic function has been pushed to the outskirts. Now this is happening in many in Bruges. It's the same in Bruges, in Belgium. You've ever been to Bruges? It's all chocolate and lace shops and Belgian beer kind of bars. That's rude. All the other stuff has been pushed to the outskirts. Spanish examples.
Old city of Barcelona.
Yeah, the old city of Barcelona. That's it. Really, it's like that. It's like that. So the crowding out that tourism is doing is that an activity which is able to pay a high rent for the central land, which is pushing away those activities which are not able to pay the same high rent for the same space. So they have to look for space elsewhere. And then you automatically see those activities shift to the outskirts. Capacity costs, for example. What are capacity costs? Another negative thing. It's also very economic. Capacity costs of facilities. Take the. Just take an example. Take the police force or take the local public transportation. This tourism, per definition, is a seasonal phenomenon. In the weekends, you have more people than in some parts of the year, more people If you are running a public facility, for what kind of demand should you cater? For the peak demand, otherwise you get your residents get angry with you and so forth. And actually doing some work for the local public transportation company in Venice now, and we discovered incredible seasonality. The state didn't even know that was existing by reanalyzing their own data. So they have to assume, they have to, and this is again the flip side of the job argument, they have to assume 1,000 local policemen in Venice, because that's what they need in the summer. And what do you do with those people in the low season? Not all facilities can be seasonalized. So you are faced, stuck with capacity costs in the low season, excess capacity that you have to pay for. There's so many negative externalities. And next to these externalities, we have investment costs, for example, and we have also operational costs, those that are actually directly linked to developing a place as a tourism destination. You have to pay the people in the tourist office, you have to pay the people working in the tourism. These are operational costs. So if you look at the inventor, if you look at the cost-benefit analysis, you immediately see that the number of positive things is much smaller than the list, much shorter than the list of negative effects. Now, what is fortunate is that all those negative externalities are not always there. Paul was the first to say, yeah, negative externalities. But what is the lucky thing with negative externalities? That really makes us a bit more sort of, a bit less anxious with respect to tourism development. Yeah, but how do they relate to the number of visitors, the negative externalities? What is their sort of their natural course? Which again is something that we need for our sort of discussion on linking cost benefit. Negative externalities are having this kind of behavior. They sort of explode when the number of users of a facility reaches a critical threshold. You understand that it's in the highway. We went this morning to Tarragona from Barcelona. Were no cars on the highway. There's no congestion. If the number of cars would double, there would still not be any congestion, no external negative external effects. But if this number of cars is multiplied by 10 or 20, then you have a sudden appearance of a negative externality. Now this is true for the costs of living, this is true for pollution. An ecosystem can support a number of visitors without having, without suffering from pollution or without suffering from tear and wear. But if the number of visitors is rising very rapidly, then you arrive at a critical threshold which is making those negative externalities explode very suddenly, very rapidly. Now it's obvious, again you get back to that, it's obvious that these critical thresholds are in fact an indication of the carrying capacity of the place. Because all those negative externalities will appear once you have reached and violated your carrying capacity. Destination. Before that, these negative externalities will be almost absent, just marginal. So these are the elements that we need to understand before we can sort of try to link the life cycle with these costs and the benefits. and therefore with the net contribution of tourism to the local economy, to the local society.
We got 1 hour to go.
1 hour to go. With or without the break?
Before the break.
Then we have
the break, then we have the
introductions. So if you speed up. Clear, any questions about this, about cost benefits and this life cycle of these? So now we go together to see where we can put these two things together and arrive at a definition, a clear good definition of sustainability. Let us have a look at the first stage. What about benefits in the first stage? What about the four benefits in the first stage?
Lower.
Yeah, very low. Why?
The number of income is low because there's not many people.
There's not many people visiting.
Many services also to offer.
There is no secondary tourism point where people can spend their money. There's no jobs being located to that. Almost no jobs. And what else?
There's no brand.
There's no brand, no image, so all these positive effects would be really marginal, very low, small. What about the costs? No externalities. No what? Operational costs. But what are we starting to see in the first stage, in the end of the first stage? Which is always necessary before you can enter the second stage. The destination's perspective.
Involvement of the local community.
Yeah, but also you start to see investment costs rising. In what, for example? Yeah, infrastructure, your airport, your train connections, your highways, your hotels, whatever, your beach. You have to clear and clean stuff, you have to protect it from the tides and stuff. So in the first stage, especially in the second part of the first stage, you see investment costs rising. Now if you sum all this, marginal benefits, almost zero, no externalities, no operational cost, but sometimes anticipation of your investment cost, what will the net effect be on your local society of tourism in the first stage? Positive or negative? Negative. I think you can easily argue that in the first stage of the tourism development process, tourism is not sustaining the local society. Tourism is unsustainable. Now this actually corresponds to our family, first family that we've been looking at 1 hour ago, of underutilization. Now the first stage of tourism development is a stage of underutilization of resources. And this means that the net balance of tourism for your local society, your local economy is negative. It is still draining away energies from your local society because you need the money, which is the risk that we were talking about before. You're taking away money maybe from other kinds of developments and you put that into your tourism development strategy. You're building beach stations, you're building airports. Second stage. What happens there? We have benefits that are exploding. We have job creation. The job creation machine is very powerful. We finished investing, but we're still investing. It is not so important with respect to. What else is is growing. What are they? Yeah, income is growing. Fabulous kind of stuff. All these investments also lead to what we said before, infrastructure that can be used by the locals as well. What about the brand? These kind of places. And let's. This is Barcelona in the 90s. Yeah, it's a fantastic brand. This is Berlin in 2005 onwards. It's Belgrade. The second stage. Fantastic image. A very strong brand. People think that that is where everything is happening in those places. They find themselves in that stage. So here we have a very, very positive net balance between costs and benefits. In the second stage, tourism development is definitely sustaining the local society and the local economy. It's a very euphoric stage of development. Third stage, and now it's starting to get tricky. Third stage.
So probably both costs and benefits are kind of balancing.
No.
For me, it's low incomes because there are more
competition.
So your incomes are
not only because there's more competition, but also.
Increase of the an all time of the excursionist takes out benefits.
I would say that there's first part and the second part in this stage. I would say that here we have a positive balance. Why we have a positive balance until this maximum in residential tourism is because there are people, a lot of people pay a lot of money. And they start to abandon the destination once they are experiencing what kind of costs?
Relation to the quality of life.
Yeah, the negative externality. Because I think this red line here is the maximum threshold to tourism development. So before this maximum threshold, we have a plus. Immediately afterwards, when the number of residential tourists starts to fall very dramatically and the number of excursions is still rising, we see income decreasing, we see the number of jobs decreasing, because the residential tourism part of the industry is much more labor intensive. But what we see especially in that stage is that the negative externalities, because of this curve that I drew before, are exploding. So the net balance of tourism development for the local society and the local economy is definitely negative. And therefore is again not sustaining the local society, not sustaining the local economy. Now this is exactly corresponding to our 1 hour ago. Our second family of non-optimal utilization. See how this economic kind of thing that we did in the beginning is converging with this idea of sustainable development, tourism destination. As I'm now convinced that this stage is unsustainable for a lack of visitors. And this stage in particular, the is unsustainable for an excess in the number of visitors. And therefore, in the first stage, we have a net contribution which is negative, and the second part of the third stage, with a net negative contribution to the local economy. So, in terms of policy, it's obvious that we should try to keep our destination, the path in which our destination is developing, in this part of the life cycle. We should get it as quick as we can over this minimum of sustainability, and we should keep it as best as we can within the limits of our carrying capacity. We get back to that policy stuff. Question.
Is it actually possible to keep it there?
Yeah, I think it is possible. We get back to the policy stuff. But just try to sort of get into the theory, get into this theory of sustainable tourism development. And actually sort of recognize together with me that you have this minimum threshold and this maximum threshold. And the maximum threshold is what we usually call the carrying capacity of a place.
I just a remark here. The feeling is that you put some plus and minuses there, but you are not actually measuring this. So the only thing you can say is ex post that you have a system of signals that may tell you that you're losing or you are gaining. Reobserve it because we are dealing with very different things that not all of them can be measured. So there is also a very important component of interpreting the trends.
Yeah.
Which is not only related to the number of visitors, there is the expenditure issue, there is the spatial issue, where are these people going, if they are all going in the same place or they are dispersing. So. But I have the feeling that more than in each state having a plus and a minus, you could think of this in terms of derivatives, of trends. So you clearly have a point where the thing is growing, a point where the economy is worsening.
I think I am totally agree with you, that this is just a theoretical sort of kind of construct. It's very difficult to translate this into empirical and practical things. What I just want you to focus on is on this minimum threshold and this maximum threshold, wherever they're lying. We have measured the costs and the benefits. We did this cost-benefit analysis just for Venice in the end of the 90s, for example. So we have tried to measure the importance, the economic importance of the brand, the costs related to pollution and so forth. Most of these effects are immaterial, very difficult to measure, just you can estimate them. So I think it is good to have a system of like early warning kind of signals, which might not be in terms of the absolute costs or benefits, but maybe in how these costs and benefits are tending to change rather than absolute kind of thing. But I really would like you to stick with the abstract kind of part. This. Then we get into the consequences of this all for tourism policy. But I think now we can address the issue of how to use this life cycle. Because I think that if you believe in this life cycle theory, you also believe in the fact that you can just classify any destination in terms of the stage in the life cycle in which they're finding themselves in, and then propose some kind of a standard recipe in terms of tourism policy. Can you understand that? The fact that I'm not so much interested anymore, since I have this life cycle, in the differences between Venice and Barcelona. Because if I am convinced that Venice and Barcelona are finding themselves both in this part of the life cycle, I already know more or less what kind of recipe I can prescribe for both situations. I don't care whether one is in Spain and Costa Brava and the other in Venice close to Jesua. And if I know, if I understand that they're both in the same stage of the life cycle, I know they have many problems in common, and I already assume that the recipe can be a classical one for places that find themselves in that stage of the life cycle. If I understand, I don't know whether that's the case, but if I think that Tarragona and Rotterdam, is Tarragona in the first or in the second stage?
Depends on the scale. Tarragona City or Tarragona?
Tarragona without Portaventura. Tarragona City.
Is it from?
It's in the second stage. So it's different from Rotterdam. It's still in the first stage. We have done all our studies, and Rotterdam continues to be in the first stage. Tarragona is in the second stage. We can do some other places. Italian cities that are in the second stage.
Treviso, for example.
You know Treviso? Where Ryanair hits the ground when you go to Venice, low cost. No Treviso?
No.
Other places in the second stage?
Many destinations in developing countries.
Yeah.
South America.
Sorry? Latin American destinations like?
Colombia.
Like some places in Colombia.
Rio de Janeiro.
Rio de Janeiro. Santiago de Chile, in China, some places in the second stage. Maybe Shanghai, maybe Xi'an, or some these traditional kind of places that might be now gaining lots of fruit without being still in a critical stage, overexploitation. So this is the first sort of, rather interesting conclusion of this Butler kind of thing with this fondant work stage is that if you can understand in which phase a place fits, which stage of the cycle a place is finding itself in, you can apply kind of more or less standard list of policies. The second very important conclusion, if you really believe in this, and I think you don't need to believe in that, but I think it's quite a powerful thing. But the second conclusion has to do with the perspective in which you need to see stuff. If there are two very important mistakes that many policymakers are making, not considering the life cycle. It's two very important mistakes. The first mistake is made in the first stage of the life cycle. And it's a mistake that they're making because they do not have a long-term view of tourism development and the potential of tourism. What is that mistake? What is the mistake you're inclined to make in the first stage? Not embracing a long-term view.
Lack of communication with
you? No. If you just have a very punctual perspective on costs and benefits. What are you inclined to do in the first stage? What does your gut, your instinct tell you?
Not to
abandon the tourism development path. That is what you're inclined to do. You see investments you're making, you don't see any return. Yet any return on these investments, you say, well, let's abandon. In some cases, it might be a very good thing, because we should be understanding that tourism development is not sort of a miracle cure for any place. There might be places that are better off investing in a creative industry or in a mechanical industry rather than in tourism. But a very sad mistake many policymakers are making is not having the patience or enough patience and not having enough vision to understand that after you've been investing, after you've been putting energies in tourism development, you should be insisting. You should even be maybe intensifying this investment process when you are in the first stage, in order to get rid of this this negative sign. Now the second mistake that people are making is again very understandable, but it's a mistake that is again lack of vision, a lack of long-term perspective that induces those policymakers to make a mistake. What is that mistake? And when is that made? Not yet overcrowding. You're making a mistake in the second stage.
Defining a brand?
No.
Not being able to control the expansion.
Exactly. That is, and you're finding yourself in this very euphoric stage in which you see benefits exploding. You see lots of jobs, you see people getting richer and richer and richer, richer because of tourism. What do you think? What you presume is that this, as long as you continue to push this process, will last forever. And you see so many places make that mistake. And what you're not, because you don't have enough vision, you don't have this long-term perspective that you were insisting on in the beginning, you're actually pushing with an increasing speed your destination towards the carrying capacity.
This could be the example of a second home.
This could be the example of Spanish homes, in could be the example of second homes in some mountain resort. It could be the case of second homes on the Belgian coastline. There's so many examples. In Switzerland, for example, they stopped allowing people to buy second homes in specific places. These are you cannot buy homes in some countries if you're not a resident.
Yeah, but they put like the quote.
They put this the quote. So it's about zoning and planning. Yeah, but this is already done by people that have this vision. And if you go further in pushing, then you might be hitting this wall that is called the carrying capacity.
There is also a question that I raise normally in my lecture, that there is an element of inevitability in this. Due to the fact that one of the things that happens when you expand the dimension of tourism activity in a place, you tend to lose the sense of control. And decisions increasingly are not taken locally, are taken by external agency. That's where if you start something that you are not able to control because there is no governance capacity locally to be able to keep hold of that process.
Yeah, but you don't, in that stage, you don't even care that you lose the control because everything goes positively. Mm-hmm. It's only afterwards when you hit the wall that you say, well, we should have been keeping our hands on our stuff more and more intensively.
That is the importance of planning.
Yeah.
Of
policy.
Hard planning, saying what you can develop and what you can't. Which heights, which infrastructure, which accessibility.
I'm more economist than powers. More, I think planning has its good and its bad sides. That's something that we're going to do in the last part of the lecture. Look at find incentives, markets, conform incentives to stop some of these sort of intrinsic mechanisms that there are in tourism development.
It's also a problem of to focus on the real main goal. What is tourism about? What we are developing tourism for? So it's something for provide people individually chance to enrich themselves, or to provide have a collective view. And thinking about what you say about second home destination in Switzerland, it would because actually there were not external agency, there was individual. Inhabitants that has the interest for selling their property, of part of the heritage, and so from its point of view, this is a limitation.
Yeah.
but then there are others that has other interests or other operation of forces that's not that that that
no, I think,
asset
I think
they
you're
can
right.
exploit for this.
Yeah, and I think that's also what Paolo said before. I think what we are now doing here is just summing costs and benefits. I mean, what we are neglecting completely, and I think that is in itself something that a good doctoral thesis might be really sort of focusing on, is how these costs and benefits are distributed in a local economy, in a society. Who is gaining and who's losing? But this distributional effect that you are talking about is essential. Because if I'm having the double minus after the carrying capacity thing, that doesn't mean that there are no people in the local economy or the local society, or even in the international, in the global economy, that are not taking profit from tourism in that stage. Can you understand that? Mm-hmm. So there's still people that have an interest in pushing tourism development even further. Because if I put a zero that's or a minus, that's the sum of everything. But what I forgot to tell you, is that still in that stage, even if the total, the sum is negative, there's still people who are gaining a lot of money from tourism. And they might increasingly be people who are not even interested in fact in how this local, how the destination, how the local society is behaving under the stress, because they're finding themselves in a place from which they're just bringing people into. It's a very good example is this cruise tourism in Venice. I don't know whether you've talked about that in some of the courses, but there's these huge cruise companies, and they just sort of use Venice as a port of call or just as a starting point, and they spit about 3 million people in Venice in the hottest period of the year, the tourism season. And these are just going up and down by taxi boats to St. Mark's Square. They visit the fake furnace for glass and stuff, and then get back on their cruise ship. So we as a city perceive them as something very negative in terms of costs and benefits, but of course the cruise companies, they really don't care about that. They're just worried that they lose that part of their route. I'm saying, let's get rid of the cruise ships. But why I'm saying that, the cruise companies say, well, we are still coming to you.
That's the problem, to keep the debate just into the economic reason. It's something that you are also to wide to ideological approach to the tourist phenomenon. Because there are so different and several interests.
Yeah, but that for me, that still is economic. For me, that's still economic.
The
distribution of positive and negative for me is a very, very huge economic. It's one of the principles of economic policy, is to not only to get people more welfare, but also and sustainable distribution of the welfare is one of the main goals of any economic policy of any country. Whether you call it harmonious development, as they did a few years ago in China, or whether you want to go to this distribution aspect, is also something of importance for economics. So don't think that it's not economics.
No, not only, but when you have to answer the question for who?
For who are you doing all this? I think you're always doing it for the people that possess the primary tourism resources, that have the moral right to use those resources.
Talking about rights. You're talking about rights, something that go over the economical, strictly economical debate.
It's, for me, the price is a management tool in order to safeguard the people that you are talking about.
Sorry?
In order to safeguard the interest of the persons that you are, the stakeholders that you're talking about.
because you assume I'm a policymaker and I represent.
Yeah, policymaker, so, you present the price that is as close as you can get it to the user value. And that's a way of communicating the scarcity of the resource so that you might sort of convince people not to come. I think prices are also instruments in a larger social and ideological debate with respect to tourism development. For me, it's very difficult to make a clear cut between economics and ideology. I think it's all.
No, of course. That's why I say that when we are talking about the economic model, costs and benefits. Yes.
But, yeah. Okay.
The real final. Answer is difficult to give through this model.
Of course, but what I would say that our objective should be to maximize or to optimize the net effect of tourism for society as a whole. And not only in the first stage, but over the whole cycle. That's why I think here we should be pushing. Here we should be starting to put our feet on the brakes. Difficulties, we are not always in control as a local community, because maybe others have taken over, so we are not even able to put our feet on the brakes or push. Other difficulty, there is a mismatch, a structural mismatch in who is taking profit of tourism and who is suffering. This is the point you were making, for who are you doing it? But there's still people with a lot of political power, lobbies, that receive benefits even if the local society as a whole is in deficit with respect to tourism. They will continue to push cruise companies, maybe some companies that have big hotels in Barcelona, they continue to push. That's the question of distribution of those costs and benefits. Those who feel the costs are usually not the people that actually perceive the benefits.
Of course, there is also a big question that I think regards the majority of destinations, like, is the capacity to shift to the current capacity limit, to manage it, which also may need to transform the destination, and make destinations that are more resilient to more tourists.
Yeah. That is the point that I would like to address before I'm doing the policy part.
You have a half an hour.
Yeah, that's okay. I'm just very quickly talking about it. Because it's essential, of course. If we know all this, it's essential to understand how much this minimum limit actually means in terms of the number of visitors and the quality of the flow. And it's essential also to understand where exactly this carrier capacity lies. You should start putting your feet on the brakes before you reach that carrying capacity. And in order to do that, you need to know where that lies. We've been working, I with my former boss and ex-friend, Paolo Costa, he's now president, we quarreled about something very intense. I continue to be friend of his kids, but I don't think we even greet each other when we. He's now president of the board, and he's one of the people responsible for getting all these stupid cruise excursions into Venice. We developed a very simple model. Just getting in the outlines. It's a linear programming model. I don't know whether you're very familiar with mathematics, but this model is just saying this, is that, and it's again something you will not like very much. This is very economic. It's saying, let us maximize the income from tourism in order to understand where the boundaries are of development, which is equal to the average expenditure by tourists multiplied by the number of tourists plus the average expenditure for the number of excursions. This is the total amount of money that is spent in the city.
very simple. And let us maximize that subject to a number of linear restrictions. And these linear restrictions all represent the different subsystems that are used by tourists when they are in your city. One of the subsystems is, for example, beds. And you can easily understand that the number of beds that the city is let's do it the other way around. That the number of tourists will always be equal or smaller than the number of beds. Mm-hmm. You understand that? Mm-hmm. If you have parking space, another potential linear restriction. The use of parking space by tourists per the number of tourists plus the use of parking space by excursionists per the number of excursionists is smaller or equal to the availability of parking space. So if you have 1,000 parking lots and one tourist in 1,000 uses parking space, how many tourists can you host in your place? 1,000 users of parking lots, you have 1,000 parking lots. It means you can host 1,000 per 1,000 is 1 million tourists. If you have no excursions. If excursions use parking lots more intensively, for example, 2 in 1,000 excursions use parking lots, and you have 1,000 parking lots, you can just host 500,000 excursions. So you can imagine that you have 15 of these sort of restrictions, beds, parking lots, maybe some primary tourism, access to the Sagrada Familia, or access to the available space where all the Ramblas. So yeah, you can imagine, you can just calculate by maximizing the income from tourism under a number of linear restrictions, that you can find the carrying capacity. And the carrying capacity is that number of excursions and tourists that actually fits within all these restrictions. Can you understand that? That satisfies all these restrictions. And this comes to, nobody knows anything about linear programming models, I suppose.
We did that in our course.
Sorry, you do that or not?
We did that model in our course.
You did that model in your course. But you thought it was your model and not our model. Your model. Who has seen this model in your course? Nobody did Paolo's course. But you forgot this. Long time ago. Let me design this thing, because that is partially answering Paolo's suggestion and demand. This model works like this. We have excursionists and tourists. I think you will hate me for not having PowerPoint presentations, but using this. This is the objective function. This is the maximizing the income thing. It pushes me out of the 0 point in this direction. Why in this direction? Why should I want to walk exactly in that direction? Because it's obvious that if I have no restrictions at all, no capacity limitations, how many people would I allow to visit my place to maximize my income?
an infinite number of excursionists and tourists. If I have no limitation, yet I'm pushing in this direction. Why do I push in this direction without restrictions? Because tourists spend four times more than excursionists. Very simple. If I'm just doing it in income terms, I will always be pushing towards tourism rather than, I will always favor tourism rather than excursion. Unfortunately, I cannot push the numbers infinitely because I have this carrying capacity, I have this capacity restrictions. Now, one of the first restrictions I will encounter is the one that I drew before. This restriction, this particular restriction with respect to accommodation, is only limiting the number of tourists. You can understand that. It's not influencing the maximum number of excursions because they don't lose beds. So when I start walking, I will hit this very particular point, which is the maximum number of accommodation available. Once I hit this point, what do I do? I start to add excursionists to the number of tourists. Now, can you understand that I have not just one restriction, but I have 15 or 20 restrictions, hotel beds, plus parkings, plus restaurants, plus farming tourism products, plus the sewer system, plus water supply, plus I don't know how many you can invent. Can you understand that in walking up, I encounter this point? This point tells me I cannot allow more excursions in my place because then I will violate this particular restriction. Now, my first optimal number of visitors is actually equal to the sum of 2 or 1 excursionist 1. If I do nothing, no policies, no adaptation, no investments, I quit and stop here. This is going to be my carrying capacity, 2 or 1 plus 2 or 2. Now we have 2 types of restrictions. These are inactive restrictions. The restrictions that determine this point, this very point, this optimum, are the active restrictions. We call them active restrictions. But there's another distinction we should be making. We also have manageable restrictions and non-manageable restrictions. Now, the manageable restrictions we can shift inwards or outwards by specific and deliberate policies. Parking lots is a manageable or a non-manageable restriction? Manageable. Just invest some money in extra parking lots, as many cities are doing. This is restricting the number of excursionists here. You just shift this restriction out by investing in more parking lots. This becomes an inactive restriction. I walk upwards and find this point. And what kind of restrictions are not manageable?
Space.
The restrictions that are linked to the, this one is space, to the primary tourism product, exactly. Mm-hmm. You cannot build another Sagrada Familia, another St. Mark's Square, or another Rambla Square.
Tourist market.
You can build another. So there are some reproducible resources, but most of them cannot be expanded or cannot be just managed as you
the
might.
Promotion of the, or the valorization of something that works.
No, St. Martin, you cannot change the capacity of St. Mark's Square by promoting it or non-promoting it. This is just a limit to development. If you're having less people, then there's no problem. You are looking for the limits here in this process. But if this restriction is related to a non-manageable facility, a non-manageable part of your tourism system, primary tourism product, then this becomes the active and definite, this becomes the tour star and the exit star in your system. This becomes the carrying capacity. I'm just wanting you to understand the logic of this linear program. It's a very powerful model. It has been working in Venice, in Rodi, in Cortina d'Ampezzo, in Cambridge. We applied it to many different situations, and it seems to work in Rome during the Jubileo. It seems to work, this linear program. It's very simple, yet quite powerful. Now, what it said to us, and now we start to talk about policies, finally. Giving you the example of Venice, I have to raise this stuff. It says that in Venice, our model said that in Venice you can host 30,000 people per day in the historical center, of which 15,000 excursionists and 15,000 tourists. So our carrying capacity is sort of 11 million people per year, of which half excursionists and half tourists. The actual figures are telling us that there are 20 million people coming to Venice, of which 80% excursionists and just 20% residential tourists. So, for a policy purpose, you now have a very important input. With the inputs, the lessons that you learn from this is, first of all, I have to get rid of people. I have to start to convince people not to come to Venice. Now, how many people I have to get rid of?
Half
of they come now. If I want to render tourism development in Venice respectful to the carrying capacity and therefore sustainable. But that's not the whole picture. It also tells you that if you want to get rid of people, the first visitors we have to get rid of are the excursionists. Indeed, there might even be slightly more space for residential tourism, because the actual number of residential tourists with respect to the optimal number is slightly below that. So very strangely, in the case of Venice, we still can have some margins for an expansion of the residential tourism market. And what we have to hit very drastically is the excursionist flow, influx. But these should be our priorities for tourism management, for visitor management in Venice. Very simple. Get rid of half of your visitors and be sure that half of these visitors, that half which you get rid of are excursionists. So now we come to you. How do you do that?
Yeah.
How do you, how, what should you be doing? Now, what is very essential, and we're still playing with it in Venice, is that we get this message that we intervene in the decision process of residential tourists and excursionists before they leave their homes. You understand that? If an excursionist arrives by car in Venice, it's already too late. You cannot sort of say, well, sorry, but Venice is full, just get back in your car and just turn around. We are full. You should sort of try to get this message
to them before they leave to come into Venice. Now this is difficult because what we cannot use is the pricing mechanism. Why cannot we use the pricing mechanism for excursion?
There is the right for access to the city.
Because first of all, we have the right, the free movement of people, which is a constitutional right in all countries in the European Union. So you cannot just close the city. Moreover, pricing mechanism is useful when people are actually buying stuff. Now, what we said before is that excursionists, they just walk around and they walk toward Barcelona and they're doing anything that you can price so that they perceive scarcity or they perceive that you are in an awkward kind of situation. They just come and they have no sensibility to prices whatsoever. You cannot use prices. So the only way, I think, the only sensible way in the end to manage to a certain extent, not completely, the flow of visitors to Venice is to introduce a booking system, a reservation system. But what we're trying to work on now in Venice, maybe also some other places, to see whether we can render the reservation to the visitors of Venice, it's a kind of compulsory thing. Stewards are quite used to reserve stuff, especially residential tourists. They reserve their hotels. They perceive Venice as a scarce route through the hotel rather than Venice itself. Yeah, you like that idea or not?
It's a little weird because book a hotel is okay, but to book a destination is like.
Is like?
I don't know. It's like we are.
To implement, it's like closing it. And
no, continue. You're not closing it. Closing
not
it is inconstitutional.
But yes, if you put some restrictions to.
Yeah, but
to
what I would
book,
say
yes,
is not saying if you don't book, you can't get into Venice. But what I would like to tell the market is that if you come to Venice without a visitor, you are welcome, but you cannot get into the St. Mark's Square area, because that's a restricted area. It's a monument, it's an archaeological kind of thing, UNESCO. All the stuff, the public goods that you will be buying in Venice will be four times as expensive as if you had your booking done before. I would really make Venice hostile for those who do not book and very friendly for those who book. Mm-hmm. Rather than say if you not book your visit to Venice, you cannot come. Now this means in terms of organizing capacity, in terms of governance, you should be getting all the different stakeholders around this project and make them sort of understand that this is in the interest of everybody. And that is not the case. I mean, that is you were saying before, there will be stakeholders who don't care about them. So that is the
But it's also a very important question in terms of management of the tourist flow. We know, especially that is a question for heritage cities. Being an excursionist is not always a question of being an excursionist because you cannot be a tourist, but being an excursionist because you choose to be an excursionist. And this is something that has to do with the perception of the place that you are visiting. If you think that you are going to go to a village here in Catalonia and you are looking at, I was in Girona last week for this meet, for this conference, and we were presenting the results of this tracking exercise that we did in Girona, but we also did one in Tarragona. I mean, 90% of the people who visit Girona, they stay in front of the cathedral for 10 minutes and this is really how you sell the primary resources. You sell it as a place where you can come back 10 times and do 10 different things. Then you also influence this mode of visiting the city.
Well, we talked about this yesterday evening or this morning. If you can convince people to stay outside Venice for 90% of their holidays to do stuff, maybe your carrying capacity, but I think you can intervene in the carrying capacity. You can shift boundaries outwards, but once you've reached, really, you reach this critical threshold, this point of really where the city is not able to absorb any more people, then you have to intervene in the flows itself. And I think the only solutions you can come up with, which is something that you can sell to the tourists, is to ask them to reserve their visit. And you say, yeah, well, we used to reserve our plane seat, we used to reserve our hotel bed. But when in 1990 I proposed to reserve entrance to the exhibition, the Fachhof exhibition, together with some of my colleagues in the Netherlands, everybody said, well, no, that's impossible. How can you ask people to reserve to go to an exhibition? We are not ready for that. But it became a really big success. Mm-hmm. Fachhof exhibition 99. It was an example we took from the United States, from some exhibitions I had in New York. And when we proposed that, there was a lot of resistance. But in the end, it was a win-win situation, because the people that reserved, and they came into the museum and they saw the pictures in a... And also the museum itself was better managed. They sold more rubbish and coffee and stuff, and the crowding. So I think this reservation thing is something you can get people used to in tourism. I said to them, because I did try to implement this reservation system in Venice. I was the chief executive of this municipal company. That's why I started to quarrel with the guy I wrote this paper with. I was head of the...
Who was Venice, the mayor?
Who was the mayor at the time, so it was not bad. Not
very bad to quarrel with the mayor.
Yeah, very intelligent to quarrel with the mayor, but because I am really... I don't care about this kind of stuff. And we had this Venice card thing starting, and we sold just a few Venice cards. But through the Venice card, we were starting to create an incentive. And after 1 year of selling Venice cards, the Venice card became one of the things that the tourist guides in the Lonely Planet and stuff were mentioning as a good way to a cheap way to visit Venice. So it was really bounded for some success, and then of course after Gorman and Mayer, they kick you out of the company and so forth. That's but we are now taking up this experience of the Venice card again in Venice to see whether we can use this vehicle of the card as an incentive to make people book their visit to such a nice place. Question and question.
No, I think it's a better way than to increase price. If you book something, I think there's a better way to manage the thing that doing price, increase price.
Yeah, because prices also are not so much useful to manage excursionist flows.
I'm wondering, in the case of Venice, what's the problem about related with excursionists? There are too many, what they are doing during their journey in Venice.
Okay. People that get into Venice as excursionists do not spend any money. Who cares? I'm an academic, nobody pays my salary because of the excursionist. Who cares? You can say, well, it's no. They cause a lot of negative externalities. How can you explain that? They have no place to leave their rubbish, no hotels, so they throw everything. Or if in the best kind of ways in the dust bins. So somebody has to collect that rubbish. So that's an extra cost for the society. Since they have just a couple of hours to stay in Venice, they all go from the station or Piazza di Roma to the Rialto Bridge into St. Mark's Square. In other words, they're also congesting the city much more than residential tourism. They are creating more, they are. All the negative externalities are being amplified because of excursionism. So they're not only costing more, they spend less. But what I think is even more important is that they come to Venice without a plan. They come to Venice without a plan. They come to Venice when it's raining in the beach resorts very close to Venice. Can you understand? I think Costa Brava, Reims, what are those people going to do? Yeah, they go to Girona, they go to Barcelona.
It's called like a rain destination.
Yeah. Or it's a beautiful sunshiny day in the south of Germany. What do those people do? They just hop in their car and they drive for 3 hours and they go to... In other words, while we can manage residential tourism because they're planning, they have a plan when they come to Venice. They know when they're going to come, they reserve at least their hotel. I think the baddest thing of excursionism is that they're just coming to Venice without a plan.
Now, am I aware about the impacts? I'm thinking about the experience, because I have the idea, I'm thinking all that you can somehow those people that mostly during their day in Venice they are not actually visiting
anything.
So all to avoid they come to Venice.
Leverage you have on people
yes.
that don't buy anything, don't do anything, don't plan it.
I'm thinking about the price, but you can stay in, get a San Marco, you can
Yeah, and then an excursionist says, who cares? Or not, it's not what you're meaning. So.
No, I'm thinking that because you say that through this discrimination, if you are an excursionist or if you are a tourist in Venice, for example, the entrance to determined places, there is a different policy price separate. But when many of these excursions that entail all these problems you talk about, they're actually not interested in visiting the place, they're still coming.
You're actually saying that there is view of Achilles here. That is the excursionists that are really, really, really not interested in anything. You say those can never ever be touched by this kind of policies. And I think you're right. I think only the sort of the most qualified part of the excursionist market can be touched by a reservation system. There will always be excursionists that say, well, we don't do anything in Venice, just walking around. We don't consume anything because we have our basket with or our case with the ice and stuff. For those people, not even a Venice card and a reservation system will be useful. They will always come to Venice. These 2 million excursionists will always get into the place. So I'm not suggesting, not assuming, I'm not pretending there's some kind of a final solution to it. I think you will always have those excursions. But what I would like to do is to get rid of the 80% of improvised excursionists and have them at least announce they're coming to Venice, because then I can already sort of start to plan for them, even if they are in excess to our carrying capacity. Can you understand that? I'm not pretending that I have a solution that gets rid of 10 million people per year that gets into Venice. That is impossible. There are now people in Venice talking about closing Venice and numero chiuso. That is impossible. I am already happy if I can get rid of some excursions and transform that into residential tourism, and to have the bulk of excursionists plan their visit to Venice rather than come to Venice without a plan. Because those are the people that actually, not because they're bad or undisciplined or immoral, but because they're often badly informed, not knowing exactly where to go. So if I can help them plan their visit better, I think I can get rid of 90% of the negative externalities.
I have a remark and a question, and then I think we should go for the coffee break. Thank you.
my remark is, well, I a number of remarks. First, this is for you. This is something that I also tend to do in my classes. We talk a lot about Venice, and we make it sound like Venice is a very special case, which it is in historical terms. It's probably the first mass tourist destination that has reached this limit already in the 80s, and where the reflection about this has already started since a long time. This doesn't mean that other places with very different characteristics are not undergoing a similar dynamics or experiencing the same problems. For example, the New World, Eastern Europe, Latin America is doing all this like 20 years later. And we see that also in the big cities that we kind of think they were not touched by this type of problems. We are having these type of problems at a different scale, which might be the neighborhood scale. So we are having the same debate now in Barcelona. Of course, the variables are different, the strategies are different, because you can, in a city like Barcelona, you can always say, okay, really, let's invest in another neighborhood where now the tourists are not going. And you are sort of shifting the problem and dispersing the problem to another place. But we are having exactly the same problem, and it was a couple of years ago where when El País said no more Barcelona model, now we're having the Venice model. And the whole discussion now in view of the next election, municipal elections, is about how to solve this type of issue. So we're having this debate, and actually me and Alan, and also Albert, who is not here today, are very involved in this debate. And we are really discussing cost and benefits now in Barcelona, and how to reduce these endogenous divergence cost and benefits that in Barcelona happens to materialize in a specific area of the city, which is the old city of Barcelona, where the most evident thing, the clue that things are not going well is that there is an extreme abandonment of population from this area, which might be acceptable for a certain point. You can say, and this is a concept in planning that has been adopted by other places like Bruges, should say, okay, let's sacrifice a part of the city, and
the golden triangle,
yeah,
and the other part,
transform it into a reserve for tourists. But you face two things. First of all, that you cannot sustain an attractive tourist product in these places if the population is not there anymore. And second, that today contemporary tourists won't do other thing but being in a reserve. So you face this type of thing. So really the discussion is about how to reduce the costs and improve the benefits. It is possible to improve the benefits, otherwise just keep what I have but make it less expensive for the society as a whole. And one way is to look at that of who is coming to your city, what is the profile, and link it to life cycle consideration, to carrying capacity consideration. The other way to approach this issue is how do you tax tourists? Or how do you tax the tourism industry to give back the cost that they produce to the local community? Which again is a very complicated thing.
Again, we can cite Venice as a very good example, because in most cities, most countries, and Venice also taxes hotel beds. Barcelona.
Which picks only the 30% of the people who is coming.
Yeah, and which picks and hurts only the most interesting part of your tourism visitors. So you have excursions again, and still free riding on your destination, and you have the quality kind of visitors which you would like even to incentivize to pay the taxes.
So really the question is, how do you tax somebody who doesn't have any transactional relation to your place? And
again, I think the card, tourist
card
can be a vehicle to have this premium price, which becomes the new form of tourism taxation.
Of course, technology is helping, because we maybe in the future we will be able really just to tax mobility of people in terms of who they are.
Yeah.
If you are somebody who booked at an hotel, you don't have to pay, but if you are somebody who is not sleeping in my city, then I tax every kilometer that you walk in my place, and there are technologies that enable.
We are studying road pricing in Venice
road
for pedestrian areas. Road pricing, like in Singapore, you have it for cars.
Yeah.
In Venice, we are suggesting it for pedestrian areas. And we have now security cameras that are able to measure the number of people, to
since are less. In fact, with these new technological developments, a lot of the tools that we have, in addition to this simple stuff.
Let me make 2 points about that. The normal approach of an economist would be to think, how do you tax the industry? You know that the industry is not all there, or at least those who really matter in the industry are not there, so you can't tax them. Secondly, you should be able, in that model, to tax only the part of, or to have a differential taxing system for that part of the industry that gets the best tourists and those who are basically alimenting this model. But you cannot do that. You cannot tax a shopper if they are selling souvenirs for group tourists or high quality goods for the best tourists. It's very difficult to intervene in this. So we have to switch and say, okay, let's tax directly the tourists. And let's try to have mechanisms like those that Jan is describing to be able to make people pay differently in terms of their profile in the city. Second important message to you is that in order to do all that, you have to know very well who is visiting your city and what is doing in the city. In spatial terms, in consumer terms, in perception terms, and that is where the field of research is very big. We only get a very small glimpse of all that with the traditional tourist statistics, which do not differentiate between anything. We only know how many tourists. If we are lucky, we know how many excursionists, but this is very precious information. But then even there, if you really know who is doing what, if you are able to build profiles of visitors with very different impacts in terms of that model, then you will be able to have really a policy to intervene with that. And this is really matter for research, applied research.
And it's very funny, because I think Paolo's first sentence in the last, Venice is indeed an emblematic case of mature destinations.
It's a worst case scenario. Yeah. I like to
just to give you some, only last year I did a survey. I had money from the city of Venice to organize a survey to interview people and to ask them what they were visiting, how they were spending the money. And there was a survey, which was a follow-up of a survey organized in 1988. So even a city as Venice is really not doing anything actually to tackle the issue.
But this is also part of the model.
And this is part of the model.
The thing that Venice is lacking the resources to manage its own tourism.
Only this year I got money, because this summer was very rainy, so there were many people getting the rain tourists getting into this. I got money from the local public transportation company to look at their statistics. I do stuff also without getting money, but when you do stuff without getting money, you don't get the statistics very often, you don't get the opportunity to get it. So, of course, even in cases like Venice, which is indeed consistent with the excessive use model, there is a really incredible lack of knowledge, which allows you not to get into, really, to get into detail with respect to the policy that you should be trying to adopt in this.
Go for coffee?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, there's still a lot to do, but anyway, I think this is really some introduction to the stuff that I'm working on and the issues that I think might be of interest for many Spanish cities too.
What happened with the mayor?
The mayor is in the prison. One of the prison. The current mayor. The former mayor. The former mayor first was the rector of the university, and we were getting along very well. Then he became Minister of Public Works, and I was his right hand to organize the jubileo. Around the jubileo 2000, he did a very nice job. I'm still proud of that. Then he became mayor, and he made me head of this Venice card thing, and then our roads divided. And now he's president of the port, so he's responsible for getting all these cruises.
Thanks.
He's like the devil. He just sells himself to the highest bidder.